Well, hello everyone. Thank you for joining us for the Family, Infant, and Preschool Program's 50th Anniversary Webinar Series. I'm Dathan Rush, and I'm the Director of the Family, Infant, and Preschool Program here in Morganton, North Carolina. And we are ecstatic that you chose to spend this next hour with us. Normally, I have the pleasure of introducing our speakers, but today I get to be your speaker. So I'm going to be sharing with you for a little while about putting coaching in context. And I have two objectives for this presentation today. One objective is putting coaching in the context of early childhood intervention. And then the second objective is keeping coaching in context with the individual families and caregivers we support. So again, thank you for joining us. We're excited that you're here, and I'm pleased to be able to share this information with you. So what we know in early intervention, early childhood intervention, is that coaching has become, over the past 20 years or so, a widely accepted practice in our field. And when we consider the professional associations that many of us belong to, professional associations that are affiliated with many of the different service providers or practitioners we have working in our field, most all of those professional associations refer to the role of the practitioner as a coach, and that one of our responsibilities is to coach and support the caregivers. And when I use the term caregivers, I mean family members, could be grandparents, it could be a babysitter, a child care provider, a preschool teacher. It's important people in the life of the child. And so our professional associations are saying that this is a role that we as early intervention practitioners have. And in fact, the American Academy of Pediatrics in October 2013 published a report on the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act Part C and the medical home in talking about the role of the pediatrician. And in that article, they included this quote, that a best practice method endorsed across diverse disciplines, and I just shared those disciplines with you, provides coaching strategies to families for use in the child's natural learning environments. And we do this because the method's shown to build the capacity of a parent or other caretaker as new skills are acquired. And their citation includes some of the work on coaching that we've done here at the Family, Infant, and Preschool Program. So even the physicians are saying that in early intervention, we use coaching. Well, how about you? Do you use coaching in your work? Let's take a quick poll and let us know if you use coaching in your work. Just indicate yes or no, whether or not you use coaching. Sarah, I can't see the poll results on my screen, so if you could just let me know.
Sure. The results are 99% of the folks said yes and 1% said no.
All right. So 99% of us indicate that we use coaching in our work, and I would be right there among us. So 99% of you indicated that you're using coaching. All right. Well, let's go a little bit deeper. And this time I want you just to think to yourself. You don't need to post this in the chat or respond in any way. You could make a note if you want to yourself. But if you answered yes, how do you know you are coaching? Just think to yourself for a minute. If you answered yes, how do you know? How do you know you're using coaching? I'm going to pause for a moment and let you think about that. As we talk to individuals across the country and really the world about coaching, we frequently hear people refer to the use of the term. People will say a number of different things about coaching, and I wanted to share a few of the comments that we sometimes get in trainings or in webinars and interactions with people about coaching. So here's what people are saying about coaching. Many times people will say, just like 99% of you did, I use coaching. We've also heard people say, I use the coaching model. We have this overarching term for evidence-based practices in early intervention. Some say, I use coaching to help lead the family to what they need to be doing. We've also heard people say, I use coaching, but I can't get the parent to engage. So it's kind of a yes, but I use coaching, but the parent doesn't always engage with me when I coach. We've heard people say, well, we use coaching in our program instead of direct service now. So coaching is kind of presented as an instead of this, we do this. And oftentimes when we hear that, it's followed by something like, we use coaching so some families get their therapies from other providers in the community, meaning that families don't access all their services from early intervention. They go outside of the early intervention program. And in many instances, the intent there is so they can get real therapy, or what some would think of as real therapy, or certainly just something different from what we do in early intervention. Now, like me, some of you may be thinking that many of these comments don't really match what you know about coaching, or how you coach, or what the outcomes that you've seen in your work with families have been when you've used coaching practices. And in fact, Carl Dunst and Robin McWilliam, in some articles that they have written, have said, and I agree, that there are terms used in early childhood intervention that everyone says that they do, but implementation greatly varies. How the terms are defined and then what we really see people doing, there's quite a bit of variance. And so let me introduce you to some of those terms that Dunst and McWilliam have referred to in their writings. Family-centered. So many of us say that we're and believe that we're family-centered, but how do our actions measure up to what was really intended by the term family-centered care or family-centered practice? Another term that is often used but is greatly variable in terms of how it's implemented is evidence-based. A lot of us talk about we use evidence-based practices. We want to use the most current research, but when we see that in practice, there's quite a bit of variability. And another term is coaching. Now, on one hand, we can think, well, coaching's in good company. If coaching's alongside family-centered practices and evidence-based practices in terms of being there with some of the key terminology that we use in early intervention. But on the other side, we see quite a bit of a variance in terms of how people define and how they're actually using coaching. In fact, a number of different authors have spoken specifically about that, that in our field of early childhood intervention, we lack a commonly agreed upon definition for the term coaching and what we mean by it. So today, in this less than an hour now that we're going to spend together, I have several questions that I hope to be able to answer for you. Where did coaching come from? What exactly is it? Why would we use it? How do we know if we're using it with fidelity? And is coaching enough? So I'm going to try to answer these questions. And if we have time at the end, which I hope we do, I'm going to try to answer some of your questions if you have them about coaching and keeping coaching in context as well. So if you have a question as I'm sharing the information, jot it into the chat, type it right into the chat. Sarah Sexton, our associate director here at FIPP, is going to be monitoring the chat. And if we have time at the end, then she's going to pose some of those questions and I'll do my best to answer them in addition to these. So coaching, where did it come from? Well, I like to say, for me, coaching started as a notion, a thought, an idea, a concept, and I was trying to figure out how to put it in practice, how to implement it, how to operationalize it. My colleague and our former director here at the Family, Infant, and Preschool Program, Melissa Sheldon, and I have spent many, many, many hours and years of our professional lives devoted to trying to figure out coaching. And it started out in a very selfish way. We were trying to figure out for ourselves, how do we engage with the adults in the young people's lives, the children's lives? Because we needed to know how to support the adults. We were great at working directly with children. We'd spent our careers up to that point doing it. But how do we engage the adults? How do we work with the adults? And I'm going to talk about why is that even important here in a little bit. And so when we started digging into the literature, and this was 30 years ago now, we looked at some of the articles, and here's one of the quotes that we found from Suzanne Campbell, highly regarded pediatric physical therapist. In 1997, she wrote that the concepts more akin of what we should be doing is more akin to being a coach or a personal trainer than a hands-on provider. Barbara Hampt, who's an occupational therapist, as well as her colleague Pilkington, and she was also our co-author on the first book that we wrote together about coaching, said that we need to move to a different position alongside the parent as a coach, rather than always taking the role as the lead player. That kind of gives us a visual about it, doesn't it? Lori Dinnabill said that itinerant early childhood special education teachers should be prepared to act not simply as consultants, but as coaches. And she and her colleagues made the distinction between consulting and coaching, and there is one in the literature for sure. So here was the road that Melissa Sheldon and I were on. This is what a typical road looks like out in Western Oklahoma, where we grew up, where we spent many years in our career until we came to the Family, Infant, and Preschool program in 2002. And so this was the road we were on, trying to figure out for ourselves and help others as we could about how do you work with adults in early intervention to support the children's development. And then in 2002, when we came to North Carolina, and this is a picture of the Blue Ridge Parkway, just north of Morganton, North Carolina, where the Family, Infant, and Preschool program is located. When we came to North Carolina, the road was a little bit more curvy because the roads here are curvy, but also because we were really deepening our understanding of coaching as it related to much of the research that had already been done here at the Family, Infant, and Preschool program. And so we dug into the research, and we used frameworks that had been developed and were being developed here at FIPP to help guide our work in coaching. And much of the work, some of the work that had been done already and research, a line of research by Carl Dunstan, Carol Trivett, for many years was that of effective help giving. And Carl and Carol and others have said that how we provide our supports, how we provide intervention and experiences for families is critical in determining the success of the intervention, how we provide it, how we use effective help giving. And there are actually two types of effective help giving that have capacity building influences, because our intent is to build the capacity or support the family in building their capacity to promote their children's learning and to access resources and supports that they need. One is relational, I'll start with, and those are things like trust, respect that we would have for the family and they would have for us, empathy, understanding. And then participatory would be the help receiver getting involved, being a part of it. It's not a passive process. It's a very active and engaging process. And then they found and defined for us through their work the three components of capacity building process, that our role as practitioners is to support the caregiver's strengths and their abilities to get to the end goal. And then caregivers will recognize and they use what they're doing now, what they currently know and do, as well as new skills and abilities that they acquire through their process and working with us to achieve their intended outcomes. And that they have responsibilities, the caregivers, for actively working with us towards these desired outcomes. So simply put, nested in this research on effective help giving is this: coaching is a specific help giving strategy. It's the way we think about it whenever we use a capacity building approach. And this is a diagram of the capacity building model that was developed here at the Family, Infant, and Preschool program has been used since that time for many years. And if you look at the capacity building practices over there on the right, and you see that active participation is required. So for effective help giving, we must have participation of the individuals who are involved in this process with us. In this case, the caregivers for the children. We need them to be a part of it. And reflection is also a key factor. We need them to reflect on what it is that they know, what it is that they can try, what it is that they can do, what it is that's working. And that helps get us to those capacity building outcomes, knowledge, skills, and based on their reflection, self-attribution, that they know what to do and that they can do it. And so we call it increased competence and increased confidence as part of our capacity building process. Melissa and I also dug into the adult learning literature because coaching really is an adult learning strategy. And so a number of authors, and this work goes way back with Knowles, looked at adult learning. And so part of the rationale for coaching is adult learning. I mean, we need the important adults in the child's life to know how to support the child's learning and development. Because as Robin McWilliam often says, all the learning for the child does not happen when the early intervention provider is present. In fact, most happens when we're not there. And so how do we ensure that the adults know what to do when we're not there? So we need an adult learning strategy that will support us. This is why Melissa and I were trying to figure out, what's our role here? How do we work with these important adults? Well, about the time that we were studying this, the National Science Foundation produced a research synthesis on how people learn. And that synthesis had three key findings that you see on your screen right now, that people have preconceptions about what it is that they're going to learn. People need a foundation and they need a conceptual framework. And so if we think about their preconceptions, it's what are their preconceptions about parenting, about their child and how their child learns and what their child needs in order to learn. When we think about the foundation and conceptual framework for adult learners in early intervention, it's their ordinary life, their routines, their everyday activities. And then we saw that third finding from this research synthesis. Everyone can be taught to reflect, to take that step back and think about what they know, what they're doing, what they could do. I mean, they all have ideas. Very rarely in early intervention, has a caregiver not tried something before we get there. If they want their child to talk, they've tried to get their child to talk and help their child and teach their child as best they can before they call the early intervention program. They don't sit passively by, you know, waiting. They've tried things. And so let's reflect on what it is that they've tried, what they think might work, what they've found to be successful or not successful. About the time that Melissa and I joined the staff here at the Family, Infant, and Preschool program in 2002, Carl Dunst and Carol Trivett had been awarded a federally funded research and training center on early childhood development that was looking at what are practices that have been found by research to be valid and appropriate when we're working with young children and their families. So they were looking into these evidence-based practices in early childhood intervention. And to do that, they were developing these frameworks. And one framework was related to developing operational definitions. And one of the first definitions that they came to get this institute kicked off was the definition for evidence-based practices that we still use today. All right, so the operational definition then for evidence-based practices was that we had to identify not just the practice, but the characteristics of the practice that, based on research, let the practitioner know what it is that we're supposed to do to get to the outcomes that the research says are possible if we use this practice. So Melissa and I began using that framework to start thinking more deeply about coaching and how we were using coaching. And so when we looked in the coaching literature, we found a very old research synthesis that really divided two types of coaching: expert-based and peer-based. Peer being two people, same knowledge, usually based on professional development. They're coaching one another to learn a new practice or a new innovation. And then there was expert-based, where you had someone with specialized knowledge and skills who was supporting another person in and coaching that individual to acquire new knowledge, acquire new information. And so in early intervention, we have individuals who have specialized knowledge and who are working in early intervention. We also have parents who have specialized knowledge and expertise related to their specific child coming together to determine how we can best support the child and promote their learning. And it's contextual. So we use natural learning opportunities, everyday activities and routines, and that's what we're coaching on. That's the content on which we're coaching. It's goal-oriented in early intervention because we have the individualized family service plan, and it's adult learning because we're supporting the adult and in some cases teaching the adult strategies that they can use to promote their child's participation. And so as we looked at this literature base, we started identifying what we call the 10 key elements for coaching in early childhood intervention. Consistent with adult learning, capacity building, I've already talked about those. Non-directive, so we're not telling the learner, we're not telling the caregiver everything that they're supposed to be doing because they already have a lot of information about their child and family. How do we use what they know to start with as our foundation? And then we fill in with what they might not know or information that would be helpful for them to know. As we move through the process with them. It's goal-oriented, IFSP, solution-focused. We're trying to figure out options or ideas for solutions, sometimes for problems that are identified or ways that we can figure out how to support the child's participation. It's performance-based. It's active. It's not passive. We don't just talk about it, but we're looking for progress moving forward. It's reflective. We think about what we know, and you've seen reflective in the how people learn research synthesis. You've seen reflection in the capacity building model, so it fits with that. Collaborative, that we're working together with another individual in the coaching process to get to the desired outcomes. Driven by context, so it's focused on everyday activities, and it's as hands-on as it needs to be. There's no evidence in the coaching literature that says that it's a hands-off practice, which is a common misperception of coaching. Speaking of misperceptions, let's take a look at the list of items that would define what coaching should not be. So the literature also helped us provide clarity about what differentiated coaching from other adult learning strategies like direct teaching, mentoring, consulting, and iterations thereof. So here are some of the common misperceptions that are not supported in the literature as it relates to coaching. And one is that you just observe the family situation or the activity long enough to just make suggestions. Observe, then give your feedback. That wouldn't be consistent with using a coaching approach. Or thinking of coaching as just caregiver implemented intervention. Now, there is a wealth of research related to the effectiveness of caregiver-implemented intervention. Some of those caregiver-implemented interventions involve coaching, and some do not. So it's not kind of an equal way to talk about, assume that caregiver-implemented intervention is the same as coaching. It's not. It's not, or coaching shouldn't be the parent doing what many would consider traditional intervention, working directly with the child, usually doing block practice, mass trials to try to teach the child something, that it's the parent doing that instead of the practitioner. That's not how we define or use coaching. Coaching is also not considered to be the same as parent training. Coaching is not leading the parent to the desired answer. I call that coaxing. If you're trying to get them to answer in the way that you have in your head, how you want them to answer, you're coaxing them into that. You're not fully using coaching. It's not referred to as any intervention that's hands-off because you absolutely can touch and interact with the child when you're coaching. We use modeling. We use demonstration. The literature played that out. It's not just asking questions or talking, and I oftentimes refer to that as couching not coaching, just sitting on the couch and talking or asking them questions. Now, asking questions is part of reflection and is something that stands out to people when they're first learning about coaching, but it's not limited to that, as you will soon see if you don't already recognize that. And it's not described as replacing something that replaces direct therapy. We do coaching instead of direct therapy. I think we really need to kind of step back from that and think about what is direct therapy in quotes. What does that look like in 2022 in early intervention in terms of how we support young children and families? So as we applied the framework used in the Research and Training Center for Early Childhood Intervention to coaching, Melissa and I came to an operational definition. So how are we going to define this based on what we're finding in the research? And we started right out with, and it's an adult learning strategy. It's an adult learning strategy. It's an adult learning strategy. And as part of that, the coach promotes the learner, in our case, the caregiver's ability to think about or reflect on their actions, what they're doing, what they know, as a way of determining, is it working or not? If so, how well is it working? How does it match what you're wanting to have happen? And then develop a plan for either continuing to do what you're doing that's working or refining it, making it better, making it more effective. And using it not just in the current activity or situation, but figuring out how to generalize or take that broader to other activities and routines as well. Now, that was the definition, but as we saw from the definition of evidence-based practices, we had to dig a little deeper and we had to figure out what are the key characteristics of the practice that inform us as practitioners. And you know, Melissa and I, our hearts are as practitioners, and when we started in this as practitioners over 30 years ago. So how does it inform us in terms of what we should be doing when we're working with families? And so we looked at research syntheses that had already been done on coaching, and we looked at individual studies. We started with over 100 individual studies on coaching from the fields of early intervention, education, medicine, and we boiled it down to 39 studies that had enough information in them for us to determine what were the characteristics of the practice of coaching as the researchers were defining it that led to the intended outcomes. And these are the five characteristics you see on the screen, that there must be an element of joint planning, planning together for what's going to happen during the visit, but also outside the visits, because there's that active participation in a capacity building model. Observation, because it helps if we can see and be a part of the real life activity so we can help support the caregivers. We want to see the caregivers, what it actually looks like, and then we want to see and help them practice or use new strategies to more promote more of the child's participation in that activity. We want to reflect on and think about what it is that they know and explore what it is that they know. Explore their ideas first for what might work. And that's where reflection comes in. Reflection is one of the characteristics that really differentiates coaching from consultation and some other adult learning strategies. And then there are opportunities for feedback. We will share information. We'll give ideas. We'll make suggestions. But first we start with where they are. According to how people learn, we have to start with where they are. So that's where the reflection begins. And many authors and others have said, okay, well, what's some of the research behind the characteristics and what additional research has been done related to that? And so here are some examples of research syntheses that and studies that have been completed that either further analyzed or justified the use of these characteristics that are coaching characteristics. And all of these references that you're seeing me share, and I know I'm going through some of them pretty quickly, they're all in one of the handouts that is available for you to download here in the GoToWebinar application. You'll have a list of all of these coaching references that I'm providing. And then the other references that I'm going to share, in fact, one I'll just go ahead and share now, which is the At a Glance for Coaching, which lists the coaching characteristics and it lists the effective help giving strategies at the top. It will help give you indicators for each of these characteristics for, as a practitioner, how to operationalize the characteristic. So in the chat, Sarah's going to enter the URL for how you can connect with the At a Glance for Coaching on the FIPP website. And then if you keep that link, anytime we update that At a Glance, you'll have an active link that is going to give you the most current version. But that's a tool that we keep in front of us and we refer to regularly, which is why we call it an At a Glance or our Cliff Notes for Coaching. So take a look at that if you haven't already and see how helpful that might be to you. So others have studied these characteristics as well and have looked at early intervention research specifically related to the use of these characteristics to further share and justify their use as a part of the coaching practices. We've also seen a number of different research syntheses that have synthesized early childhood intervention research based on the operational definition that Melissa Sheldon and I put forth several years ago. And so here are some examples of some of the coaching research syntheses. We also have other authors who've described in articles as well as texts how they've used coaching in early childhood intervention and coaching as defined using our operational definition and using the characteristics that we put forward. And then people often ask, well, what are the research studies that say that coaching is effective, that it's an effective practice and it has positive outcomes for young children and their families? Well, here are some examples of research studies that have been done over the years that are based on the operational definition that we provide, as well as the five characteristics that I just shared with you. So if you're interested in looking into how they operationalize the characteristics as part of the research and the outcomes that they achieved, then you can take a look at those articles in that reference list. So that brings us to the question, is coaching enough? Is coaching enough? And I think this answer coming from me might surprise many of you. The answer is no. It's not all about just coaching. Coaching can be an element of our practices, but it's not. This is why we don't call it the coaching model, as if it's an overarching model for all that has to be done in early intervention in order for us to be effective. It's one tool that we have in our early intervention practitioner toolkit. So many of you have heard Melissa and me say over the years that coaching is not a service delivery model. Coaching is not a service delivery model. It's our adult learning method. It's our interaction style. I often say it's our bedside manner, so to speak. You know, when you go to your physician doesn't set you down the first time you meet them and say, okay, here's how I interact with my patients. Here's the way that I'm going to talk to you. They don't do that. They get to the intervention, so to speak, reason that we're there. So they don't take a lot of time to do that. And in early intervention, a lot of times we spend a lot of time explaining coaching and trying to provide our rationale for coaching to the exclusion of natural learning environment practices or the context. You know, the reason we don't have practitioners in early intervention working directly with children and focused on blocked practice activities is not because we use a coaching interaction style. It's not because we use coaching. It's because of the importance of context. And it's because of the important adults in the child's life who are more important than we are and who are with the child more than we could ever possibly be. So coaching is not a service delivery model. It's a tool in our toolkit. It's a tool and an interaction style that we would use as an adult learning strategy and as a way of building the capacity. But we've got to keep coaching in context. And the context is not just the natural environment. I'm going to explain more about that in a minute. The context is natural learning opportunities. And so what we really want the important adults in the child's life to understand is that all young children learn through opportunities to participate in everyday activities and routines. Mealtime, toothbrushing, bath time, watering the dog, planting the flowers in the garden, running brother and sister to soccer practice, sitting out on the soccer field, watching them, kicking your own soccer ball. Those things that are the fabric of everyday life, that's the context for early intervention. And we use these activities because they're ongoing, because they provide opportunities for the child to participate and require the child to practice these new skills that we and the families want them to have. And they don't have to work on it in block practice trial and then be taught to generalize it. Generalization is inherent because they're using it in the real life activity. So it's for those reasons that we use coaching to help the important adults know how to use natural learning opportunities to support child participation and foster child learning. And so here's the context. The context are these natural learning opportunities. And you heard our first two speakers in this webinar series, Dr. Carl Dunst and Dr. Robin McWilliam, talk about strengths-based and child engagement. And so we use, and research plays this out, these are research-based characteristics, child interests. Child interests, reasons why young children want to participate, because they're interested in something. They like water, so they like to help with washing dishes, or they like to take a bath, or they like the part about brushing teeth. Maybe not the toothbrushing part, but they sure like the part where you turn on the water and you get to splash around in it. So how do we use child interests to engage them and involve them in the activity? And how do we use everyday activities? Everyday activities are the context for our intervention. Mealtime, bath time, getting dressed in the morning, the getting out the door routine. And then we support caregivers in knowing how to be responsive, follow the child's lead, say the word like the child would say it if he could, know where to put their hands to facilitate the child's movement from maybe a sitting to a up into a standing position, or take a turn and wait, or teaching them how to use a word or use the sign, or teach the child to use a word or sign. Caregiver responsiveness to promote child participation. Now, what we know is that coaching can be used effectively in isolation. Somebody could be coaching outside of natural learning opportunities. Let me give you some examples. So it could be that the practitioner, early intervention practitioner, is focused on teaching the parent how to facilitate squat to stand for the child. And so they're trying to get the child to pull up to the side of the couch. So they get a favorite toy, and they shake the toy or get the child's attention with the toy up on the couch, and they facilitate the child pulling up to stand a number of times. Now, to the child, what does it get for the child? Well, if the child's successful, it gets them more reps, more practice opportunities, block practice. But is that what typical play really looks like? Stand up. Okay, let's let him back down. Stand up. No. Speech boxes. I've seen people use speech boxes, that they fill these boxes with toys and activities that they want to use to promote words, promote the child labeling and using words to talk. And so the parent sets the child down, and they've taught and coached the parent how to use the speech box to produce words. Meanwhile, all around them, these activities are happening, and the child gets in trouble because she's not focused on the speech box. She loves her big brother, who's putting his shoes on and his jacket on because he's headed outside, and she really wants to go outside with big brother. See, we're missing the boat. But they can use reflection, decontextualized. They can use observation. They can get the parent to practice using the speech box. Another example would be, we've seen people in early intervention set the child in the high chair, have the parent set him in the high chair, give raisins on the tray, and the child has to pick up the raisins to practice pincer grasp and put the raisins in a cup, one after the other. Like, they can't eat the raisins because they're working on pincer grasp, putting them in the cup. Decontextualized intervention. Are they using coaching? We could say that they are. They're meeting the characteristics of coaching. But see this diagram on the slide? It's separate from the natural learning opportunity. And so we're going down the wrong road, but using coaching. So what we have to do is keep coaching in context. We use coaching in early intervention in context of natural learning opportunities. And there's, and if I didn't mention it, there's a at a glance for natural learning environment practices that Sarah's gonna post the URL in the chat so you can access that to give the indicators for how you use those three characteristics. So we bring coaching together with natural learning environment practices and early intervention. The everyday activity is the context in which and on which we are coaching, and we're incorporating the child's interests, and we're coaching the parents or the caregivers how to be responsive to the child to get the child to participate, which then teaches the child important skills that we all want them to have. So what are the characteristics of coaching that assist us in keeping it contextualized? Well, let's look at three in particular, three of the five. And the first one is observation. So when we're observing from a coaching characteristic perspective, we should be observing the real life activity. We're observing what meal prep looks like, how the child is involved in that, and then we're observing how the mealtime goes and how the parent says that he wants the mealtime to go and how it's going right now. And then we want to support the caregiver in learning and using some responsive strategies that are going to assist the child to more effectively participate, like the parent wants the child to, in the mealtime activity. And that's action practice. The parent is practicing those strategies while the coach observes. Now, if the caregiver is having a difficult time grasping or understanding or picturing what this would look like, then that's where we're going to switch roles. And the coach is going to demonstrate or model only if needed, not in every circumstance, but we're going to model or demonstrate using the child, of course, in the real life activity, in the real life mealtime, or in the toothbrushing routine, or whatever the activity would be. So where it's appropriate for that would be appropriate for the coach to model. So the caregiver would observe only when needed, but we're in the real life activity. And then joint planning is the coming together of our ideas in terms of what's going to be happening between visits and what's going to happen on the next visit. Let me show you a diagram that I put together that I hope will help clarify, because I can't tell you the number of times I've read coaching logs or I've seen individuals indicate that they were using coaching, but they seem to just show up on the visit as on a designated day and time. And they would ask the caregiver, now what is it that you wanted to work on today? And so caregiver wanting the child to learn new skills says things like sitting, walking, I want him to say some words, so all skills, or colors. But all those things are learned in the context of activity. So the life cycle of an early intervention visit is something like this. We start by revisiting the between visit plan, because between every visit, every early intervention visit, the caregiver is committed to participating in an everyday activity with the child and supporting the child's participation in that. We don't ask, what do you want to work on between visits? We ask, based on what we did today, the activities that we did, what is it or what activity are you going to be doing between now and the next time I come back where you want to continue to practice these same things with your child? And so that's where it comes up. Well, I'm going to use diaper changes, or today we did mealtime. So every meal and every snack, I'm going to use what we did today to help him be able to use his spoon more by himself instead of me having to feed him. So then we revisit that plan. So last time when I was here, you said at the top of the circle, you said that you were going to, at mealtime and snack time, you were going to have him use his spoon more independently, and you were going to help him if you needed to until I came back. So tell me how well that's been working. See, that's reflection. I'm asking them a reflective question to analyze the between visit plan. And then when we kind of finish that part of our discussion, then we're going to enter into what I call the this visit plan. What did we agree that we were going to do on this visit in terms of activity, not skill that we're going to work on, not block practice or exercise session, or not call it play, but really make the child do exercises. But what's the activity? And so the activity might be snack time, because we did lunch time last time, and we're continuing to work on that independent feeding skill for the child. Or it might be that we're moving it into another type of activity setting for the child to be more independent. Like I came when the child is getting dressed, because we're going to support the child's dressing routine and use some of the same strategies that we used before. And so within this new activity, I'm going to use action practice. The parent's going to be practicing and trying the strategies that we're talking about. The coach is going to be observing. If the coach needs to demonstrate and it's appropriate and it's necessary, that can happen, and the caregiver can observe. We'll reflect on that. If feedback is necessary, that can be provided. So I'm using my coaching characteristics. And then we come down to the end of the visit. And I'm going to ensure that I'm keeping coaching in context, because we're going to get a new between visit plan. So what is it that the caregiver is going to be practicing and trying and supporting the child's participation in between now and the next time I come back? It could be what we did today in terms of the context. It could be something associated or something completely new or related that they're going to commit to doing. And then when I start the next visit, I've got a natural starting point, but it keeps it contextualized. I never have to go in and ask, what do you want to work on today? And because I have a plan, and the parent knows, the caregiver knows that we have a plan, we have activity, one or two activities that we're going to be doing as a part of the visit, because it's easier for them to learn what to do when we keep it in their real life. If I detach the skill and skill learning and skill development from real life routines, and I just practice exercises, I'm focused on getting the child to really basically do block practice exercises, it decreases the likelihood that the caregivers are going to do that when I'm not there. But you know what they are going to do? They're going to feed the child. So they're going to have some kind of mealtime or snack time. They're going to make sure the child gets dressed. They're going to change the child's diaper or toilet the child. See all these activities that are going to happen, whether I'm there or not, and they're all natural learning opportunities that can enhance the child's development. But we got to keep coaching in context. We don't coach in isolation. We coach on natural learning opportunities. So you may ask, and this was one of my questions that I started with, how do you know if you're using coaching with fidelity? Well, here at the Family, Infant, and Preschool Program, over many, many years of work and design and redesign and looking at the literature and research on relational help giving, coaching, and natural learning environment practices, we have developed a checklist that is related to this. And the checklist will help you determine the extent to which you are using these three practices, relational help giving, coaching, and natural learning environment practice, or practice areas, with fidelity. And when I say with fidelity, I mean in the way that research has proven and shown us that they should be done. Not the way I prefer to do it, the way research has guided us in terms of what was effective, what was the most effective way in doing this. And so Sarah is posting in the chat right now the link to what we call the FIPP, the Fidelity in Practice in Early Intervention. And it's a checklist that you can use on yourself. It's a good reflection tool. It's a checklist you can ask someone else to use as they're observing you. You could video one of your virtual visits with permission of the family, and then you could go back and use the FIPP to determine, are you and a colleague? So you could do peer-to-peer coaching and coach one another on how to use the FIPP and bring your practices more in line. then you can determine on this checklist the extent to which you are using the practices with fidelity. The checklist goes hand in hand with the guidance document. So you download both the checklist and the guidance document to ensure that you're using these practices with fidelity. So let's review what we've talked about so far. Coaching is joint planning. It's observation. It's providing opportunities for action and practice on the part of the learner so they get to try it. And if it doesn't work, then you can help them tweak it, or they can help figure out how to tweak it. You reflect with them so they can think about what it is that they're doing, recognize what they already know. That's so confidence building. And then provide feedback if you need to. We affirm what it is that they're saying. We can give additional information, and we can give ideas after we've allowed them the opportunity to reflect first. But all of these coaching characteristics are used in the context of natural learning environment practices, promoting child interests. And child interest is the reason young children participate in activities, not just a reward for participating. Think of child interest as the reason they participate, because they like it or they like the person that they're participating with. Child interests are the parenting superpower. If you know your child's interests, it's a superpower. You can support your child in learning and doing all kinds of things. Everyday activities are our context. We coach within context, and the caregiver responsiveness of the strategies that formerly in our traditional direct therapy interventions that many of us used to do, those were the strategies that I would use to teach the child. I'm handing those off to the parent, who's going to be very competent and capable of using those strategies within the context of their everyday routine. Well, I can't leave you without giving you a challenge. And so here's the challenge, or here's some action that I would encourage you to take based on this hour that we've spent together today. First, I'd encourage you to reflect on how are you using coaching and natural learning environment practices, and how do you know that you're using it effectively and in the way that it's intended to be used according to the research? And that's where your FIPP checklist could come in. I encourage you to take action by keeping coaching in context in the real life activities. We want to not just coach on skills or isolated practice or drill. Coach caregivers to do what they would be doing, supporting their child's learning as a part of these activities. The child likes music and the family likes music, so they're going to have a dance party. The family has to run errands, so they've got to get the child in and out of the car successfully without a tantrum. And they could sing songs while they're in the car. They have to eat. So mealtimes, we're going to keep coaching in context during the activities that they have to do, because it's going to provide repeated opportunities for practice. And that's what we like. That's what we want to have happen. And then use your resources. So I've shared a couple of resources with you: the coaching at a glance, the natural learning environment practice at a glance, the fidelity in practice and early intervention checklist. And in fact, if you'll go to our website at www.fipp.org, we have an entire collection of tools and materials related to coaching and natural learning environment practices. So check out our website and our case collections, if you will. Sarah, I think we might have time for a question or two before we have to sign off for today.
Sure. We got a couple of questions. The first one is, how do you keep coaching in the context of natural learning environment practices when the family is very focused on skills, like I want my child to be able to talk?
Mm-hmm. And of course, the families may be very focused on skills, and likely when they come to the early intervention program, it's because they want their child to, the three most common are talk, walk, and eat some way. And so a question I would ask, so if they say, I want my child to talk, I'm going to ask them, when would it be most helpful for you and for your child to be talking? Now, I'm prepared for a common response, which is, well, all the time. I want them talking all the time. Now, inside my head, I'm thinking, are you sure about that? You really want him talking all the time? But as a speech language pathologist, I'm like, yeah, that's great. But my next question is going to be, okay, yeah, I agree. I would want them talking, you know, more talking all the time is great. But if you had to pick one or two times during your day where it would be really helpful to you or your child, if your child was talking, when would it be? See, when questions are going to help us get to activity settings. And usually they're going to say something like, well, at mealtime, it would be helpful because right now he just points and grunts to what he wants. And if I can't figure it out, then he throws a fit. Okay, so mealtime. When else? Getting dressed in the morning because it's just unmanageable because I think I know what he's trying to tell me that he wants to wear, or I just pick something out and then he won't wear it. Okay, then let's start with mealtimes and dressing time. And there we go. We've got two contexts that we're going to start with.
Thank you, Dathan. We've had a couple of questions kind of in the same vein. How do you help practitioners get to fidelity with coaching? And then once they're at fidelity, how do you help them stay there?
Okay. Well, the fidelity in practice and early intervention really is a key tool or checklist for helping practitioners get to fidelity. Because what we've done is we've identified and tested these indicators of the practices for relational help giving, coaching, and natural learning environment practices. And so through the observation, either live observation or video observation, then you indicate the extent to which these characteristics are being operationalized, the indicators are being used. And the guidance tool will tell you what it should look like and what it shouldn't look like. And so it gives you very specific guidance for what you would be doing. And so we would use that tool to help get to fidelity. And then it's good to do fidelity checks because we all, you know, slip and slide from time to time. And so we'll do a fidelity check, and a fidelity check would be do another FIPPY. And so we encourage that to be done every 3 months, every 6 months, do a fidelity check to make sure you're staying true to the practices. Because for many of us, I know for myself, this was new learning. This wasn't natural to me. I had to learn how to do it, and I needed support from my colleagues and myself reflecting on it to stay the course. Well, that brings us to the end of our time together. And so I hope that this has been helpful to you. I hope you're enjoying our 50th anniversary webinar series. I want to encourage you, if you have not already enrolled for our April webinar, which is going to be on April 22nd, presented by our Associate Director, Sarah Sexton. She's going to be talking about the early intervention orientation process, and she's going to give you an orientation framework. So if you're a program manager, if you're a professional development person, a TA person, or if you're an early intervention practitioner who's had part of your job responsibility is to help orient new staff members or new contract providers, you're not going to want to miss this webinar. So we hope to see you back here in April. Thanks so much for participating with us today.